It's not all fun and games at making it work, but we do usually find a way to have some fun. Thanks for tuning in. I'm so glad you're here. I'm Jimmy. We're gonna spend a day in the shop. Right now, we just listen to an incessant beep. Can you hear that? I think it's coming from upstairs. It's been doing it for a month or so, no big deal. Like a lot of things, it needs a little bit of attention, I think. But we'll figure it out. Once it moves up on the list of priorities, we're gonna get it taken care of. Oh yeah. What we'll do is we'll put some clips in on what you can expect to see in today's video. Dodge Ram Rebel. Look at this. That thing got a Hemi. Silverado LTZ. Classic Silverado. We got a lot going on out here. We got big trucks in disarray. Semi-repaired, semi-apart. I'm not sure what's going on with them. Maybe waiting on some parts. But you saw some clips. You probably know what's going on. It's a dreary, gloomy, wet, rainy morning, but the sky's clearing up. You can't even see it, can you? Look at that sky. It's clearing up. That's what we had a few minutes ago. Now it's getting nice out. The sun's coming up. It's gonna be nice today. It's been kind of a really odd week. Seems like the parts are always wrong and stuff's not getting sold the way we recommend. I'm not sure what's going on with all that. It's a little messy. It seems there's more help up front, but it seems more chaotic. I don't know what's going on, but I know the shop overall is doing really well, and that's what's important. We're gonna have to join the longshoremen soon. Anyway, we always make the best of it. We always find a way to make it work. Whether it's a hot rod, a monster truck, a classic car, or an Explorer Sport Track with 390,000 miles on it. We're gonna make it work. Let's finish getting the shop open up, do what we can to learn a thing or two, have some fun, and straighten out this mess. Stay tuned. Look at this, 2018 Dodge Ram Rebel with the Hemi. Service trailer brake system, service electronic braking system, service air suspension system's coming right up. At least it does when you first start it. It's got no suspension, basically it's bottomed out. I'm guessing this thing has some kind of air compressor and all airbags, but oh, there it is. Service air suspension system. 225,309 smelly work truck miles. It's been through some stuff. It's gonna need a little love. We're gonna have to try to get this thing fixed up a little bit. The vacuum must be broken, I'm guessing, because it should be loved. You go out of your way to buy a Ram Rebel. I want to lift it up and look around underneath first. It's definitely squatting down. We'll see if there's any visual damage. And if not, then we'll go ahead and hook the scanner up and see what kind of trouble codes we might have. Definitely has a big old air suspension in here. And it's gonna need tires soon, but they're not that bad yet. They're really close though. I think all four corners are air suspension. Yep. But I don't see any, it's on the bump stops, obviously. I don't see any visible damage, but normally what happens on a system like this is one of the airbags starts leaking and then the compressor runs all the time and then the compressor burns up. That's normally how it goes, but this thing, look at them brakes. This thing needs front tires very soon, brakes right now, and the air suspension diag has to be finished. That's what they really came in here for, but we got to do a free safety inspection, so we'll have to make some notes about all the other stuff, and then we'll grab the scanner. All right. Drop this down here into potato chips and see what we got. I was pulling it in. I opened the door to look and see where I was on the rack and I put it in park. Yeah, well, I'm gonna update the computer. The Pro TT X431 from launch needs a little update. So we'll take care of that. We'll get these two talking, see what kind of codes we have. probably got to check fuses and things like that. Sometimes the compressor will just run so much with a leaking airbag, it'll burn it up. Sometimes it'll blow a fuse. Sometimes it'll just go into safety mode after it times out and turn itself off. So, but we'll figure that out once we get these up. Oh, what? That's easy. Installed successfully. Refreshing. Hope you guys got to take advantage of the Prime sale on these things. So I had a link in the description below. It'll probably still be in there. I'll probably leave it in all week. If you want to pick yourself up one of these, it's been a great little tool. My only complaint, no kickstand. Every time I got to put it somewhere, and I bought that little stand I keep on my cart, but I try not to carry that around and put it in people's cars so I don't forget it. Eventually, like some of you have suggested, I'll attach something to it. I just haven't got to it yet because I'm busy. I'm gonna let this cook a while. We'll come back. I had to get out of the vehicle. Chrysler EV, DS Chrysler, or regular cart? I'm gonna go regular Chrysler. 2018 Ram 1500 DS. I had to get out of the vehicle to do the Wi-Fi tango. It's kind of weird. I was sitting in the truck with the windows and the door open. I just had like, it was going between 47K and 200K. And I got out, went over by the left side of my Icon toolbox there, and did it in about a minute. So I guess the Wi-Fi from here to there, or maybe being in the vehicle, was a factor. Kind of strange. Uh-oh. I hope I don't need a subscription for this. Maybe I'll finally break down and do it. Without unlocking the gateway, you can only do... you want to log in? No. Fail to unlock. Yes. Maybe I need to go talk to him about unlocking the gateway. Give me a subscription for the scan tool. I've talked to Top Don about updating my Phoenix Light 2 or even upgrading to the next scanner, but they haven't contacted me back in like a couple of weeks. So, but I like this tool. I just wish it had a kickstand. That's my 100% only complaint with this tool. I'm gonna at least get codes out of it, I'm hoping. We will see. And maybe Top Don will contact me back and let me know about using one of their tools again, because that was also a great tool, but the subscription's expired after 2 years, so. All right, I probably can't get data. What the heck is this thing? Oh, okay, he's got the ACs not on correctly, at least in my eyes. It's never slowing down. I'm like, why isn't the fan slowing down? Because it's freezing cold in here. Anyway, BCM, humidity sensor module. Nope, this is Florida. It's normal. It's just freaked out about it. anti-lock braking system, steering wheel position sensor, signal bias level out of range. Zero adjustment failure. Air suspension control module, invalid data bus from ABS control module. Low air mass. Ride height system manually switch off. Air suspension down button stuck. Air suspension up button stuck. Ride height pressure vent control performance or incorrect operation. Payload limit exceeded. Air suspension reverse valve 1 control performance or incorrect operation. Ride height air pump control component or system over temperature. Integrated trailer brake. Implausible data from ABS, so it doesn't like what it's seeing from that. Electronic power steering, invalid data from ABS. Radio, cabin EQ mismatch, driver's door module. Internal missing calibration, window control short to ground. Passenger door module, same codes. I'm gonna note these codes on my work order. I already sent the report as well, but I'm gonna take my work order to the Identifix and go over some of these codes in Identifix and see what direction we need to go. I'm gonna guess checking fuses, clearing codes, and seeing what happens at that point. Apparently they're not going anywhere. I might have to cycle a key too. Takes a minute. Gotta be patient. You know what it might be? It won't let me clear the codes because I don't have a subscription. Chrysler. The only brand that does it. And it looks like they're on the verge of bankruptcy. A lot of research. This system doesn't work the way I thought it did. I mean, they're all basically the same air suspension systems, but this is a sealed system. It doesn't pull in air from the atmosphere to charge up the shocks. And it has a sealed system that you put nitrogen in, about 175 PSI, so that you can find out what airbag's leaking and how things went off the rails. Now this also has an overloaded code and it has no air for sufficient testing. So I'm thinking he's towing a trailer with this thing that he probably shouldn't be. It's a half ton. So 500-600 pounds of tongue weight and like a 6,000 or 8,000 pound trailer. And it's a work truck. It definitely smells like one. So I'm guessing that he's overloaded it and popped the rear airbags and taken out the suspension compressor. I'm not sure. But at the very least, he probably has a leaking airbag and it needs to be recharged with nitrogen, 175 to 200 PSI. I checked the fuses. All the fuses are good, all that kind of thing. So it's nothing crazy. Those are the two fuses. This is the 40 amp fuse. And this is the 20 amp fuse. One works the module and one works the actual compressor itself. And they're all good. So the problem we're going to have is I have to set up a R122 or R134 fitting and a nitrogen tank and be able to fill this system just to test it. And we don't have any of that equipment. So I told him, if you want to set something up, we can set it up. I've basically got an hour into it with all the research and all those other things. So I said, let me know if you want to go further and come up with a system to fill it so we can test it and find out what happened, what's leaking. And either it's going to need probably rear struts were overloaded and pop the bags. And we could put them in and charge it up and then the system will run and go through all the testing and resetting the heights and all that stuff. But I also can't clear the codes to even try that unless we get the subscription for my scanner. So we're going to work on that. And they're going to talk to the customer and see what he wants to do. Honestly, I'm pretty much over working on Ram and Jeep cars that you have to have a subscription for. As you guys might know, everyone keeps telling me, just get the subscription. But that's up to them. If they want to get a subscription for my scanner, then it'll be a lot easier to work on them. And then we'll just get a nitrogen set up and all that kind of stuff. And we'll be all right. We'll see what happens with this one. That's the bottom line. I think my parts are here for this fiasco, so we'll move on to that. Look at this. We got the right one. I showed you yesterday, if you watched that video, this Ford doesn't have just one kind. There's a couple of different angles they can be on and cool stuff like that, so you got to make sure you get the right one. And that's what we got now. So I've cleaned up my gasket surface a bit. I'm going to sneak this back in there and get it in this hose down here. I need a vacation. That's basically the bottom line. I'm going on a vacation soon too. In a couple weeks, I'll be going on a four-night cruise. 5 days and four nights, I think my wife said it was. I need a refresh. So we're gonna have a refresh. I'm gonna try to plug those in before I get too crazy. This came with the sensors and everything, by the way, too, which is pretty cool. Look at that, huh? You'd never even know what happened. Oh, there's supposed to be a second screw in that thing. I took out one screw yesterday and it came out. I said, man, that was kind of easy. It's supposed to be a second screw on the bottom. There's a nice little ridge down there in the bottom of that housing that fits in the hole good, but you still gotta make sure it's turned exactly right so those bolts will start nicely. This one back here seems to be a little too far down. I wonder if the threads are stripped in the manifold. These bolts are the same length. But that one in the back drops all the way down. I wasn't sure if it was going to tighten, but it did. I'm not sure why the bolt was so much further down. Maybe it's just the angle of the housing on the manifold or something, but I got to look up the torque spec. I think it's 80 inch pounds, but I got to check it. Now I'm going to use an extension and a swivel. I know. I have a lot of options though, where this is located. If I had the engine on an engine stand, it'd be fine. And I will say that doing it this way is still closer than not doing it at all. FYI. I hear the keys. Oh, we're gonna have fun today, man. Trust me. We're gonna have fun today. We're gonna turn around. Everything's gonna go smoothly. Parts are gonna be right. And they'll be filled because I'll be able to fix. So that'll be cool.
Oh, remember I mentioned a dime yesterday down by the thermostat housing? It's actually a temperature tab. Like this is a Jasper engine or something like that. I didn't think it'd be the original engine with 388,000. And the aftermarket puts those little tabs on a rebuilt engine, so if you overheat it, it voids your warranty. It's still there, and this thing had to have been overheated going low on coolant, right? I don't know. Maybe it's glued on too well. The hose isn't quite right, but it'll work. At least I think it will at this point. Should have been a little bigger here and a little smaller there, but I can't flip it around the other way because it won't reach. Making it work. I got the bottom clamp tight on the little bypass hose. Electrical connectors are in. And put my screw in there, then I can start rolling my alternator bracket up. Now there's two bolts here, and then the one down by the tensioner. It's also got this cool little tab that when you line everything up, boom, it kind of helps you. Tells you there's your spot. And it's easier to find a hole that way. Let's try this. There we go. The fan blades are like just barely letting the bolts clear. 15 millimeter. Got my mid-length gear wrench socket. Perfect length. I know the lower bolts still threaded in, so I don't have to worry about lining them all up. Buzz them in. Tensioner and the main cable. Once all that's buttoned up, the upper hose is easier to do last. That way, that hose kind of blocks everything in. So we'll do that last. That's a long bolt. That's good. Connected. Throw the belt on there next, I think. Gracious goodness. Okay. Let's not do it this way, man. Come on. Come on, with it. I know it's around here somewhere. Oh, you know what would help?
Oh,
move
light.
I'll move the light over. I got technology. Even without a Snap-on weekly tool payment, I still got light. Something they told me wasn't possible. No tool truck payments, no light. Just how it goes. Oh, I had it too and it fell out. Started talking smack.
Just slip it in there, Jimmy.
Slip it right in.
Oh yeah.
That's it, big daddy.
Okay,
now we'll take this, what we call in the industry, contraption. And we'll snake her around here. Maybe it goes the other way. I don't know. It must, because that's not looking right. I thought from memory I pulled it out facing that way, but what do you guys think? I think I was right the first time, and I'll have to switch it back. Oh, that's right. It goes behind the oil dealio. If it seems confusing to you, imagine how that feels. I took it apart and I don't remember. I try to make sure the clamp is going to face a way that, you know, if I put it this way, it's going to be under the throttle body. This way, you could probably get to it without disassembling the whole engine. That's my theory. I might have to shorten this hose because it looks like it's going to rub on the hose behind it. We'll see how it is once it's all the way on the neck. It kind of blocks the transmission dipstick, but thinking if I take about an inch off of here, this is going to come forward. It'll clear the transmission dipstick and clear this oil cap a little bit more too. This is an abrasion sleeve, so you got to make sure you always transfer those, because especially with this kind of a design, it's going to abrade. I don't want to take too much off. I'd rather go back in, take more off, and find out I cut too much. Then we'll have to wait an hour for another hose, so we don't want to do that. I think the blade's getting dull on this tool. I've had it so long. The guy I was pretty friendly with, the Pep Boys, gave it to me. Eddie Capillo. He gave it to me when we worked there in the 90s. Long time ago. That seemed to help a little bit, clearing stuff.
the connectors for the TPS seem a little bit easier with it unbolted. Now I'm gonna round up my screws. I'm gonna get this mounted up. Fire this thing up soon. If you didn't see yesterday's video, first of all, why not? Second of all, this is a 388,000 mile Explorer Sport Track. Oh, a little bit of chain rattle. They almost always do that. It actually runs pretty good. Now we got coolant to stay in it. We're gonna have to verify that by warming it up, making sure we get heat out of the heater and warm air off the radiator from the fan once it's warm. And if there's an air pocket, it'll just keep getting hot and it won't stop till it burps. But I don't think that's the problem with these. They're pretty forgiving. We'll see. They're working on a nitrogen setup for the Dodge Ram. I guess they want to continue on it, I'm thinking, because they were asking me information about doing that. We'll see what happens with that one too. And maybe it's something else, though. I see people carrying rotors and AC condensers and compressors around, but I'm going to try to get one of those myself so I can pay my bills. Temperature's up. I got warm air off the radiator. Making sure I got heat out of the heater doodle, whatever they call that thing. It's definitely getting way past outside air temperature. Okay, we're pretty good. Now what I'll do is I'll let it sit a little bit, cool down. Double check the coolant level, and this one will be done, just like the Chime. That thing got a Hemi? Yep. Is that thing just towed in? Yep. Something really wrong with this thing. It's got a pretty bad coolant leak, I'm guessing. When I tried to drive it in, and it got about halfway in from the parking lot, it started shaking and running rough. I don't know if it's going in protection mode or something like that. The damage might already be done. It came from another shop. It's got a floor mat in it that's not from us. 92,469 miles. See if it runs good momentarily. Yeah, it's running good right now. Pretty clean inside. It's probably like a 6, I guess. But it's weird. It'll run a minute and start shaking and running really bad. I'm gonna try to find a coolant leak before I run it too much. I'm not sure if there's any coolant in it at all, actually. You can definitely smell coolant, so something popped. Maybe a radiator or something like that. Uh-oh. That's not good. I poured water in there and it's just pouring out the bottom. So the radiator's leaking, but something I spotted, I don't like the look of that either. It looks like a head gasket. We're gonna have to do some kind of block test. The problem is with the radiator leaking that bad, the block test probably won't be accurate. We could fire it up and try to pour some more water in here and see if it bubbles the water. If it's extremely bad, it will do that. We could also pull the spark plugs out and look at spark plugs, see if any of them are damp. This has 16 spark plugs, so we'd have to get permission to do that. You probably could replace the leaking radiator and then go from there. It needs a radiator either way, unless they're gonna scrap the car. It might need a radiator and an engine. Very possible. Let me talk to them up front and see where we're gonna go with this vehicle. It was just towed in like a half an hour ago. Sometimes you write too big of an estimate and then that's how they end up. Look at this 2014 Chevrolet Silverado LTZ. Driving it up here, I thought there was something wrong with it, but it's just those chopped up off-road monster truck tires. It's it really feels like the suspension's falling out of it because the tires are so bad. I believe 178,000 miles, and she's a cream puff. I'm gonna say that's probably like an 8. Man, the thing's in good shape, but the AC don't work, so I got on my sexy glasses. And I got my black light. Let's take a look. Now, these tend to be compressor or condenser.
Uh-oh.
That don't look right.
That's the good corner. Where the problem starts.
Oh, look at that. Oh, can you see it? Oh yeah, that's not supposed to be like that. You can probably see that without the glasses on. Let me give them to you just in case. I want you to see too. But condenser's leaking. That's easy. The bow tie brigade. Condensers and compressors normally what leak on these. Sometimes the cycling switches will go bad and that kind of thing, but putting the machine on, I knew it was low on refrigerant, so it's about half the outside air temperature. That's no good. They said, you know what? Parts are on the way. Go for it. Customer's waiting. I'm like, uh-oh. I probably shouldn't have had lunch first. But I was hungry. Got to get some clipper doodle tools and unsnap the snapperoonies. Sometimes you can get them with a pocket screwdriver. It's easier with the correct tool. We'll get some of these out of the way. And GM's been watching the European car manufacturers saying, and Japanese, everyone does it, I guess, nowadays. They're like, you can't have all the fun. We want to use some of these too. It wasn't long ago, this would have been like 6 or 8 10 millimeter screws. These little push pins, they cost a lot less. That's why they had to raise the prices. I think most of it comes from the safety and convenience things that they're doing with newer cars. So they find other ways to reduce costs. That way they only have to double the price of the vehicle. All right, now I sound sarcastic, I apologize.
They took out the drive shaft.
Uh-oh, got no drive shaft?
No.
That happens on them. The transfer cases make noise, so they take the drive shaft out and trade it into CarMax.
You gotta have all of the push pins out to lift that off. Sure. FYI.
Oh, I see some stuff. My goodness, what are we gonna do now?
Look at this mess. That's not good. What the heck? This is not on. This is not on. Someone's been playing around in here. A lot of these here goodies is out of place. I don't know if this car was in a little bender fender or something, but I'm gonna take this cross member out. I think those like bolts are like facing up from the bottom or something silly like that. I know that bolt's gotta come out. Gotta find them though, that's the problem. They're like, air box might have to come out. Washer bottle or something, if it's in the way, I gotta see. I might have to look up the procedure, I just don't want to. I think I can figure it out. What do you think? Couldn't get to the bolts under here. For some reason, they face up. And there's three, I think? There, yep, there's three. And they're kind of hard to get to, but I think I could pop some more plastic push pins out and get on some of them a little easier. Five more just like it. Sorry for making you dizzy. It's not supposed to come out easy. You gotta work for it.
Aha. Just roll it over, that's all. Turn it 90 degrees. Comes right out of there.
This is where the condenser's leaking. In case it was hard to see before, you can actually see it's wet right there. So I'm pushing all this rubber trim back in place and all. I got to disconnect some lines and unclip it from the radiator and it should lift right up. Take that plastic cap off. And there's tools to release these. But I find they're finicky and you got to tinker for a few minutes. So especially on a component I'm replacing, it's going to probably come with these clips. So I'll just remove them. I'll save them in case the new part doesn't have them. That'll just pop out of there now. But I gotta get the AC lines out at the bottom. The AC lines are right down here, but I can't really see them. I'm gonna take the battery tray, well, this is just a air filter tray in this case, I guess. Battery's in the back, but I'm just gonna take it out of my way, see if I can see stuff underneath it. It's only 4 10-millimeter bolts, so, well, technically they're 6-millimeter, but the head is 10-millimeter. If you wanna get all generic engineering on me. Well, there's a cool little slot right here that seems to be for just this purpose. Of course, my little wrench is a little flappy, so. But I got it. Even though it's flappy, it still works better than you might think. Now I gotta pull this back. And there is, just for entertainment purposes, I'll show you something cool. You guys get a kick out of it, because Bill and Bob, they put a 10-millimeter bolt down there. I guess I could say it's probably needed, because might be some vibrations and stuff. So I'm gonna get out the old quarter-inch extended reach ratchet. That should come right out.
Let's see. Ow, ow, ow.
Watch the sharp stuff.
Ow, 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 ow.
All right, now. There it goes.
Nailed it.
Stop asking nicely. Uh-oh. Don't worry about that power steering fluid. That's fine. I thought the hoses were on a manifold attached. They're not. Oh, we're making a mess.
Like Diddy.
Like Diddy. The little bracket I took off, you have to unbolt. It doesn't come with the new condenser. You got to swap over these plastic shields. Got a lot of noise over here. We got a fan, we got an AC machine. I apologize. Trying to give you guys a shop environment, 100% hardcore. Look, there's my condenser now. I just got to see if it matches.
Look at that son of a gun.
They're both on a little bit of an angle. The factory ones are straight, but the hose is on rubber, so it shouldn't matter. Now, let's get this in. Bottom of the condenser is just slots into the radiator. The top is where it's clipped. Gotta have it even from left to right. Sometimes they pop right in, sometimes they don't. There it is. Gotta make sure this is all the way out, relaxed, trapping the condenser in. Couple new gaskets on them. AC line, hoping I can sneak this in with my gravity check, dang it. Went to a regular box wrench since it spun off pretty easy. I thought I was going to have to fight it all the way. That's snugged up. Going to clean some of this mess up and start the vacuum system going. So that'll be done by the time I finish buttoning it up. Get this line in. It's not exactly right. It's aftermarket stuff, you know. Can't use the radiator to bend it, but it has to be bent. Not much I can do about it. Now this says transmission fluid all over it. Still wants to fight me a little bit. I heard something. Yep, my clip relaxed. Should be all the way in. Plastic cover. Gotta get this side out here. Look at that, man. Practically falls in there. It's easy, I told you.
Piece of Jimmy.
Piece of cake. I just got one more to do over here when you're done. I'm not gonna shove my box in yet until I get my radiator bolted in.
What are you doing?
Might be battery mapping it. I got more battery where that came from. Watch your fingers.
Hey, what in the?
Get you one of them.
Oh,
As long as the threads are as good as the original ones when we're done, everything's okay. Hoses and stuff. Oh, there it goes.
Okay. Nailed it.
Nailed it. Now I gotta put my ducts on because I like all my ducts in a row. Gotta put my connector on my push pin in my AC machine back on because we're on a vacuum. 30 minutes coming right up. I got a couple push pins I gotta put in here and this panel.
Boom.
And everybody wins.
Everybody wins. I'm out of bolts. I'm not out of plastic covers and push pins though.
Oh.
I don't need that flashlight. I got another one just like it. Actually, that's not true. I lost my other flashlight in that Jaguar. He hasn't come back. Eventually he will, and it'll be right there where I left it. I'm gonna put these push pins in. Thing's got another 13 minutes to go. And we'll see how this AC works. I think it holds 1.02 in a Suburban, 0.6 kilograms in a pick 'em up truck. Yeah, it's a pick 'em up truck, so 1.2 pounds about, give or take. We are charging and we are gonna fire it up. Passes the vacuum and a leak test. I got another AC check, I think. Oh, I'm so sad right now. Auto. Uh-oh. When they put these custom wheels and tires on, they probably didn't put the sensors in with it. That feels nice. That feels nice. My hands are a little dirty, so I'm not gonna drive it. I'm gonna let Rob take it for a drive, and I'm gonna go look at the other AC check, I think. But everything feels really good with this one. Quick and easy, down and dirty. It's always nice when you're looking for a low refrigerant problem, you get your dye light out and you find a clear cut evidence of dye and a leak. That way everyone's happy, you fixed the leak, you know you fixed it. Well, at least you know you fixed that one. It's not impossible to have a new leak down the road, but that one's the only one that's leaking right now, so we're good. Air's working good, got the sweet two-tone interior. Back on a growling, rumbly road. Look at those pressures.
Perfect.
Ooh, look at that old classic Silverado. Remember when they used to be easy to work on? Look where the AC connectors are. Doesn't get any easier than that. High side, low side on the same line. If you guys are mechanics, you know why, but if you're not a mechanic, the restriction is right here where you see these little dings. There's an orifice in there. It's called a fixed orifice. Usually somewhere between 22 and 40 thousandths or so, depending on the car and all that kind of stuff. But the pressure hits here from the compressor under high pressure, and then the orifice is a restriction. It turns it into a gas on the other side, and that's what pulls heat and humidity out of the system. When the pressure drops, it attracts the heat and humidity inside the car and the evaporator. The accumulator gets oil and stuff in it, has desiccant bags for moisture, and then the system sucks it back to the compressor. Cycling switch, accumulator, and apparently it has a little bit of a leak. It's not blowing quite as cold as we'd like. Let's fire it up and see. It doesn't look too low, but it might be. If we start it up and it goes under 30 on the low side, then we know it's low. He says it's cold sometimes and not that cold at other times. So basically what happens when the refrigerant's low, the demand is low, it'll still feel like it kind of works. But when the demand is high and it's real hot out, it's not gonna work. So let's see what it feels like. 141,516 miles. I believe it's a 2004. We'll check and make sure. It's definitely not working too great. It sure had already been cooler than that. It's in the shade and it's overcast. 2003. Real nice truck. Got a little couple dings and scratches. It's seen some use, 2500, but it's super clean inside and out. You guys tell me what you think the love rating should be. And it's super low on refrigerant. Let's see if we can find a leak. Let me get my dye light. There's no obvious leaks. So we're gonna try soaping up the Schrader quartz. Oh, that's terrible news. That's definitely leaking. I think I figured out your leak, sir. These caps, they're dust seals. They don't stop refrigerant leaks. So we put two Schrader valves in this thing, call it a day. Well, you know, we can do two. These are, yeah, it's a little wet in there. These are bad for leaking too, although the connector's dry, but still. Since it's such a high failure item, we'll soap it down. That looks okay.
Jimmy,
looks okay.
You're so good at this.
Yeah, that looks all right. Even though there's no dye, might as well spray these down. We got the soapy water out. That's just soap clinging for its dear life. Two Schrader valves, evac and recharge. Now, if the cycling switch is leaking on these, you can change them without evacuating the system, because there's a Schrader under that, just like here. So you can unscrew that without a leak. But you can't change the Schraders without the refrigerant coming out. So we'll have to vacuum it down, which is not that full. I'd be surprised if it has, you know, 2 or 3 tenths of a pound. And we'll get a couple Schrader valves. We should have them in stock. And we'll get this thing fixed up today.
Schrader valve collection.
Try to keep this latch in case it slides off of here or something. Let's put it over here. Got the refrigerant out. Should be able to do these now. Just like a tire valve, basically, same thing, but they're different sizes. And one of my tools is broken, but I got the big side, and this one small and medium. So we'll see what we can do. I'm gonna try the medium one. It's rarely is a small one, but it could be. Right? This one might even unscrew. This might be the aluminum fitting that unscrews. Let's take a look at this one. The low side one is always a removable Schrader, but the high side is often an aluminum cased housing and Schrader. Might have to get me some needle nose to grab that out of there. And I gotta get an aluminum thread in one. That's in a different selection. Got the old one out. Got the new one in. I also try not to bottom these out all the way. I don't know why. It just makes me feel better. I don't know if it's necessary to not bottom them out, but I've had better luck that way. These just unscrewed. It's probably a special wrench for them or something that they want you to buy, but that usually works too. Just got to be careful if you're going to, when you remove these, that you don't, the tube doesn't turn with it, because you can break them, break the weld around this or something. You can put a wrench there if you have any doubts, or it starts to turn. Now these match this up pretty good. This has a plastic or hard rubber seal inside, and that's what tends to let go. Make sure the threads are the same. A little refrigerant oil on the O-ring. You wouldn't think a 2003 Silverado could have a new car smell, but seems like it. When you tighten this, you don't have to go crazy. It's almost like an oil filter. The O-ring is the seal. You just want to tighten enough it doesn't back out, and the O-ring is sunk down in the right location in the receptacle. Now we can vacuum this thing down. He's gonna have AC this weekend, yay! Hope he has it on Monday too. Quick 15-minute vacuum on this, because we didn't have it open for long. So now we're gonna fill it with refrigerant. See how this thing works. I'm sure it'll work good. Everything looked good before, just low on refrigerant, so it was cycling. It needs some headlights, but
I would get the GM headlights. That way they're expensive, but they last again. The replacement ones will be okay for a couple years, and then they'll fade too. Ooh, that's a lot of seat cushions. Settle down now. Now, I'm feeling nice, chilly AC coming out of here. If we close the door, put this on recirc, oh boy, it's gonna get cold. So AC's working good. That's the bottom line. It's got a little clutter, but it's pretty clean. And for a GM, the seats tend to, the bolsters get all wore out, but maybe because he sits on cushions, their seats are in good shape still. I'm gonna say 7. If it wasn't for the clutter, I'd probably go 8. What do you guys think? Needs a little love on the steering wheel. That's the one problem for me when something's really nice. Then I'm like, wow, you know how nice it would be if I could just change this button and get a steering wheel that's in better shape. Then it would just be next level, right? So like, where does it end? Just your daily driver, right? That's where we're in today's video, guys. I appreciate you spending the day with me. I had a lot of fun. We got a lot done today. It started out a little sketchy. The past couple of days have been sketchy, but today was pretty good. We got a lot of people fixed up. I'm gonna be able to pay my electric bill after all. I'm just kidding. I don't have any problem paying my electric bill. But in any event, I hope you'll torque the like button on your way out. And more than anything, I hope I'll see you in the next video, because you're awesome.